Father, we thank you for the great, great love wherewith you have loved us. We thank you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for the mighty, mighty power of your word. So glorious. The glory, the glory of the word. Wow. The glory of the word. The glory of the word. You know, I just saw this. We see the Lord. Wow. We see the glory of the Lord. We see the Lord as glorious. But when do we ever talk about the glory of the word? I'm telling you, I saw it. I saw the word opened up like this. And just the glory of God shining out. I mean, just radiating the glory of God. I'm just taking a look here. I have no doubt there are scriptures that's it right there too. Psalm 119:105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The entrance of your words gives light. It gives light. It's understanding unto the simple. Thy word is very pure. Wow. The glory of the word. The glory of the word. The glory of the word. Well, of course, we know. I mean, it's very obvious. John chapter 1, verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. And the Word was made flesh. Oh, there it is right there. There it is right there. See, I knew he would lead us to it. Look at this. John chapter 1, verse 14. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. I knew he would take us there. I knew that he would. I knew that he would take us there. Wow. The glory of the Word. The glory of the Word. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory of the Word. The glory of the Word as of the only begotten of the Father. Full of grace and truth. Jesus is full of grace and truth, and the Word is full of grace and truth. I don't know why I'm preaching so hard already, but I am. Oh, man, that just struck me. I've never talked about that before. The glory of the Word. The glory of the Word. Wow. The glory of the Word. You're going to have to exercise some patience right now, because I don't know where we're going from there. All I know right now is the glory of the Word. The glory of the Word. I have nothing else beyond that yet. Now, of course, I have the message that I was planning to talk about tonight, but he's showing us something here. I just want to make sure we stay on it for as long as we need to. Okay, yeah, that's interesting. Let's see. Yeah. Acts chapter 9. Verse 1. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, now this way meaning the way of the Lord, meaning those that are followers of the Lord, followers of Jesus, whether they were men or women, that he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven, the glory of the Word. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? In other words, why are you persecuting me? What an interesting question. Have you ever thought about that? Here it is, Jesus shows up with such glory, with such power, it knocks Paul on his face. Paul, who has been preaching against Jesus and putting people into prison who are preaching the gospel of Jesus, killing and stoning people that are preaching Jesus and the kingdom and the gospel of the kingdom. And he says, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Man. Why are you doing this? Saul, why are you doing this to me? I mean, you can see, at least it appears to me, he's asking that question. It doesn't just sound so innocent. Like, well, Paul, what are you doing to me? Well, Saul, he's not Paul. Yeah, he didn't change his name to Paul. He's saying, Saul, why are you doing this to me? Now listen, this is the Lord who knows all. And yet here he is coming to Saul and says, Saul, why are you doing this to me? It's almost like I can just sense the hurt in his heart, like, Saul, my boy, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Why are you living like this? Now look at this. Look at this. Here is Saul, who's been persecuting the believers, persecuting the Christians, stoning them, killing them, putting them in jail. And his response to the question that Jesus asks him is, who are you, Lord? He immediately knew that it was the Lord. he couldn't deny the glory of the Word. He immediately called him Lord. Who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you persecute. It is hard for you to kick against the pricks or the goads. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what will you have me to do? Look at that. Look at that. Here he is. 2 minutes ago, on his way to go send out letters, to bind up every single one of the Christians. And 2 minutes later, after the glory of the Word shows up in his face, he is calling him Lord, and he says, what do you want me to do? What would you have me to do, Lord? Whatever you want me to do, I will do it. And the Lord said unto him, arise, and go into the city, and it shall be told you what you must do. And the men that were with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. Wow, do you remember? I think we mentioned that either last week or the week before, about how it's so interesting that when someone in the Bible has an encounter with the Lord, when they have an encounter with the Lord, it's rarely, almost never, except for maybe a couple of exceptions, one being the book of the revelation of Jesus. And I would say the other being Ezekiel. All the other times, they never record what the Lord looked like, but they always record what he said. Oh man. They always record what he said. And here are these men that were with Paul and Saul. And they didn't see the Lord, but they heard a voice. They heard a voice. They heard a voice. The glory of the Word. Oh my. Wait a minute. Oh, there's more coming. Just wait a minute. Ooh, I think it's in here. Let's see. Oh, it's not there. I know it's here somewhere. No, I know where it's at. Let's see. I know where it's at. Don't worry. It's in here somewhere. Ah, there, I knew I'd find it. I knew it. I knew it's in there. Oh, man, I'm telling you, he's showing us some stuff tonight. All right, look at this. Psalm 29. Oh, this is so good. This is so good. Oh, this is so good. Oh, man, I hope this stirs you guys up. Wow. Oh, my. Give unto the Lord, O you mighty. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. Glory, reverence. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. Yea, the Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes them also to skip like a calf. Lebanon and Sirion like a young unicorn. The voice of the Lord divides the flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord makes the hinds to calve and discovers the forests. And in his temple does everyone speak of his glory. This is good right here. The Lord sits upon the flood. Margin, it says, the Lord sat enthroned at the flood. The Lord sits king forever. The Lord will give strength unto his people. Watch this. The Lord will bless his people with peace. The glory of the word. The glory of the word. Wow. Wow. The glory of the word. Of course. Of course. Oh, Wow. Wow. I'm just waiting here to see where we're going to go from here. The glory of the word. Whew. Wow. The glory of the word. The glory of the word. The glory of the word. Wow. The glory of the word. The glory of the word. I don't know. There may be more to this. I'm just waiting. The glory of the word. I mean, hey, I don't know. The glory of the word. Well, what else, Lord? Where else do you want me to go here? Okay. The glory of, wow. Wow. Okay, let's go. Jeremiah and chapter 31, and we're going to start in verse 31. So Jeremiah 31:31. I wonder. Let me look at something else. Whoa. Wow. All right, let's hang on to your spot there in Jeremiah 31:31. We're going to go back there, I believe. But look at this one. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Wow. Okay. Just be patient with me here, guys. Wow. Oh my. I'm seeing this and processing it here as we're going here. All right. Wow. Oh my. Okay. Wow, this is amazing. Okay. Okay, chapter 2 Corinthians chapter 3, let's start in verse 1. Do we begin again to commend ourselves? Or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you or letters of commendation from you? You are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as you are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And such trust we have through Christ toward God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of us as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God. Now look at this. This is just kind of a side note, but I have some things that from when I had studied this out previously. Now this word says, but our sufficiency as from God. That word sufficiency means adequate power and qualification for our purpose. It also means confidence, and it means ability or being adequate. So our qualification for his purpose, his sufficiency is our adequate power. It is our confidence. His sufficiency is our ability. Okay, look at this. Who also made us able ministers of the New Testament. Now look at that. There's a little number 2 next to that. And I'm guessing it's going to say covenant. Yep. In the margin, it's translated covenant. So look at that. Who has made us ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Now hang with me here. I'm going somewhere, but I want you to see some of this leading into this. Look at this. But if the ministration of death, written and engraven in stones, was glorious, look at this. He's talking about the covenant being glorious. In other words, he's talking about the glory of the covenant. Wow. Oh, this is amazing. So, but if that was glorious, so the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit, meaning the ministration of the new covenant, how shall that not be rather glorious or more glorious? How shall that not be more glorious? So what he's saying is the old covenant was glorious, but the new covenant is even more glorious. See, that's what the Lord was showing. Right when we went back to Jeremiah 31, the Lord said, the glory of the word and the glory of the covenant. The glory of the covenant. For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more does the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious, meaning the old covenant, had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory that excels, or because of the glory that excels, meaning because of the glory of the new covenant that even far excels the glory of the old covenant. Now, but look at this. This is very important, okay? Because what he is saying here, he is not saying that the old covenant, hey, look, that's the old covenant. It's dead. It's done away with. It's nothing. It's worthless. Don't pay attention to it. No. He's not saying that. He's saying the old covenant was glorious. The old covenant was glorious. The covenant that God made with Noah was glorious. The covenant that God made with Abraham was glorious. That he made with Moses was glorious. That he made with Isaac. That he made with Jacob. That he made with David. The old covenant was glorious. And he's saying, even though that old covenant was glorious, yet the new covenant excels it in glory. It excels the old covenant in glory. Wow. But if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remains is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. In other words, he was just saying that the glory that would fade away, the glory that would pass away, but see, the glory of the new covenant, it never fades away. It never passes away. It never wanes. But their minds were blinded. For until this day remains the same veil untaken away in the reading of the old covenant. He's saying they had to put a veil over it. There was even a veil over the old covenant. Which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when one shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we, now watch this, but we all with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory. But we all with open face or unveiled face, as in a mirror, behold the glory of the Lord, which means we are able to behold the glory of the Word, the glory of the Word with unveiled face, with unveiled heart. I mean, with a heart wide open that we can see into the depths of the glory of God that is in the Word. But we all with open face, unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, the glory of the Word, are changed into the same image from glory to glory. From glory to glory. Even as by the Spirit of the Lord. See, it's the Spirit of the Lord that makes the Word glorious. Now look at chapter 4. Goodness, you guys, look at this. Verse 3. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Watch this. Lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ. Wow. And in the margin it says, the gospel of the glory of Christ. This gospel, this word, it is the gospel of the glory of God, the glory of Christ. The glory of the Word. Wow. I'm going to read that again. In whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, or the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. The glory of the Word is what rakes through the darkness, the areas of the mind that have been blinded by the work and the lies of the enemy. The glory of the Word is the light that breaks through that darkness so that a person then can see accurately again. So that they're not seeing through the lens of the lies, but they are seeing now through the lens of the truth. For we preach not ourselves, but we preach Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. He has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ, the glory of the Word. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Go to verse 16. I don't know whether this has any connection to it or not. I'm just going to read it. For which cause we faint not. Well, he's saying we faint not, because as he goes on here, he says we are troubled on every side, but we're not distressed. This is back in verse 8. We're perplexed, but not in despair. We're persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe and therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. Knowing that he which to raise up the Lord Jesus shall raise us up also by Jesus and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might be through the thanksgiving of many, redound to the glory, to the glory, to the glory, to the glory, to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not. Because we know what he is doing, and we know that in the end we win. For which cause we faint not. We do not lose heart. But though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, works for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Wow. This is amazing. We've taught these scriptures several times, but I'm seeing this in a fresh new way here. It's the glory of the Word. It's the glory of the covenant. The glory of God is in the Word. The glory of God is in the covenant. The Word is the gospel of the glory of Christ. Okay, now go back to Jeremiah 31. In verse 31. Now look at this. Look at this. Now we're going to look at this now from a new perspective. Through the perspective of the glory of the Word. Through the perspective of the glory of the covenant. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant. That's the new covenant, the New Testament. So he says, the days will come that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. So he's talking about the new covenant, the new testament, the new covenant that he made with us through Jesus. He said, which my covenant they broke, although I was as a husband unto them, saith the Lord. Look at this. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, and I will write it in their hearts. And that's what we just read in 2 Corinthians. He said, we wrote it on your hearts. See, the Lord, whoa, come on, man. The Lord, look at this. The Lord writes upon your heart the new covenant. He writes it upon your heart. He said, I'm going to put my law in their inward parts, or in their mind. I'm going to write it in their hearts. See, he put his new covenant in your mind, and he wrote it in your heart. So how do you know that, God? Hey, listen, guess what the Bible says? The Bible says, I believe it's 1 Corinthians 2:16. It says that you have the mind of Christ. So if you have the mind of Christ, of course you have his covenant in your mind. I will put my law in their mind, and I will write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, saith the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Now he goes on and he continues talking about the covenant, and he's talking about what they didn't do, how they did not obey his voice. And then he goes on to say, in 32:40, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them, that I will not turn away from them to do them good, but I will put my fear in their hearts, that they shall not depart from me. Now look at this. Let's see, is this what I want to get to? Well, okay, let me just read up to it just a bit. Chapter 33. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah the second time while he was yet shut up in the court of the prison, saying, as where he's in prison, thus saith the Lord, the maker thereof, the Lord that formed it to establish it, the Lord is his name. Yahweh is his name. Jehovah is his name. He says, call unto me, and I will answer you, and show you great and mighty things. Now, my Bible in the margin where it says mighty things, in my margin it says inaccessible things. He says, call unto me and I will answer you, and I will show you great and inaccessible things which you know not. Verse 6, behold, I will bring it health and healing, and I will heal them. and I will reveal unto them the abundance of peace and truth. And I will cleanse them from all their iniquity, whereby they have sinned against me. And I will pardon all their iniquities, whereby they have sinned, and whereby they have transgressed against me. And it shall be to me a name of joy, a praise, and an honor before all the nations of the earth, which shall hear all the good that I do unto them. And they shall fear and tremble for all the goodness and for all the prosperity that I procure unto it. Verse 14, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have promised unto the house of Israel and to the house of Judah, that good thing being the new covenant. See, in a few different places here, in a few different places, Jeremiah talks about the coming of the Lord. He talks about the coming of the Lord, the branch of righteousness. And that's what he's talking about here, what he's promised to Israel and Judah. Although there, well, there it is right there, verse 15. In those days and at that time will I cause the branch of righteousness to grow up unto David. Don't you love that? When the Lord just confirms it right away? Oh my goodness. He said, in those days and at that time I will cause the branch of righteousness to grow up unto David. And he shall, and of course that's talking about Jesus. Okay, that's talking about Jesus. And he shall execute judgment and righteousness in the land. In those days shall Judah be saved, and Jerusalem shall dwell safely. And this is the name wherewith she shall be called. Now he's talking about the church here, the bride of Christ. She shall be called the Lord our righteousness. For thus saith the Lord, David shall never want or lack a man to sit upon the throne of the house of Israel. Neither shall the priests, the Levites, want or lack a man before me to offer burnt offerings and to kindle meat offerings and to do sacrifice continually. And the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah, saying, thus saith the Lord, if you can break my covenant of the day, and if you can break my covenant of the night, that there should not be day or night in their season, then may also my covenant be broken with David, my servant, that he should not have a son to reign upon his throne, and with the Levites, the priests, my ministers. Verse 25, thus saith the Lord, if my covenant be not with day and night, and if I have not appointed the ordinances of heaven and earth, then will I cast away the seed of Jacob. What he's saying here is he's saying, listen, if you can break my covenant that I have with day and night, and if you can stop day and night from taking place, if you can stop the sun from rising, if you can stop the moon, if you can do that, then sure, my covenant can be broken. Now look at this. This is so powerful, you guys. Because what he's saying here is the only way for you to break my covenant that I have with you is for you to overpower me and for you to overpower the covenant that I have with day and night. In other words, my covenant cannot be broken because there is nobody that can ever overcome me. There is nobody that can ever conquer me. Lucifer tried and he failed miserably. He failed so miserably. Excuse me. He failed so miserably that he was thrown out of heaven so fast that he went from heaven down to the earth as fast as the flash of a lightning. So he is giving us the reassurance that because he is God, his covenant cannot be broken. His covenant with us can never be broken. He will always uphold it no matter what. Because there is no one that can overcome him and break his covenant that he has with day and night to stop day and night from taking place. Now listen, that's the glory of the covenant. The glory of the covenant is that it can never be broken. The glory of the covenant is that it can never be broken. The glory of the covenant is that it can never be overtaken. It can never be removed. It can never be taken away from you. It's the glory of the covenant. So whatever you find in this Bible, whatever you find in this Bible, you can have it. You can have it. Because it already belongs to you according to the covenant. You've already got it. It already belongs to you. And we just have to do the necessary things that the word commands us in order to walk in the fullness of the covenant. Because as we talked about maybe last week or the week before, there are always those things that we have to do on our end to engage the covenant to produce. It's not automatic. It's not automatic. If it were automatic, everybody would just have it. If it were automatic, everybody would have more than enough money. Everybody would have more than enough health. Everybody would have more than enough love. Everybody would have more than enough peace. But that's not the case. Do you see what I'm saying? So there's always our part that we have to play, or you could see the conditions that we have to make. Remember, it's a covenant. It's a covenant. A covenant is a two-way agreement. So each party has to uphold their end of the covenant in order for it to be enforced. So anything that you find in this word, you can have it. And when you find it, you look and you see, okay, what must I do to have this? Come on, man. That's it right there. That's it right there. You find out, what must I do, Lord? What is my part? What must I do to engage the covenant? Wow. Boy, I hope that went deep in your hearts too, the way that it did to me tonight, because that, I'm telling you, I never even thought about that. The glory of the word, the glory of the word, the glory of the covenant, the glory of the word, the glory of the covenant. Man. All right. Let's close this thing up here. Go to Isaiah. Oh, okay. We don't have time to get into that. Go to Isaiah 53. Now, make sure you have your communion. When that's ready. Now, we're going to take communion tonight. And we're going to take it over Isaiah 53 for healing. Actually, let's start in chapter 52. Let's start in verse 11. Depart ye, go ye out from thence, touch no unclean thing, go ye out of the midst of her. Be ye clean that bear the vessels of the Lord. For you shall not go out with haste, nor go by flight. For the Lord will go before you, and the God of Israel will be your rear guard. Behold, my servant shall deal prudently, for he shall prosper, and he shall be exalted and extolled or lifted up and be very high. Now, this is talking about Jesus. As many were astonied or astonished at you, his visage or his form, his appearance, was so marred more than any man. It's always a hard part to read. As many were astonished at him, his visage, his appearance was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. I mean, he was unrecognizable. So shall he sprinkle many nations. The kings shall shut their mouths at him, for that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected of men. He was despised and rejected of men. Now look at this. He was rejected. So he took rejection so that you don't have to be rejected. He was rejected, so you're not rejected. So don't ever let anybody make you feel rejected. Because you're not rejected. And in fact, the reality is, those that are trying to make you feel rejected are most likely unbelievers that are actually the ones that are rejected. Because unless they've accepted the Lord, they're not accepted. And so he unfortunately rejects them. It's a sad truth, but it's reality. So he is despised and rejected of men, so that you're not rejected. A man of sorrows, so that you don't have sorrow. Acquainted with grief, so that you don't have to have grief. See, you're free from grief. You've been delivered from grief. You've been delivered from sadness. You've been delivered from depression. So when we take communion tonight, we're taking communion over all of this. And so in a moment, all of this can become yours. Because this is what he has done for you. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs or our sicknesses and carried our sorrows or our pains. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, or he was crushed for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. See, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, so that you no longer have to be oppressed. You are now free from oppression. You are delivered from oppression. Yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before her shearers is dumb. So he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? He was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He had put him to grief. When you shall make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and he made intercession for the intercessors. Wow. Okay. It's so heavy. It's like, it's hard to even do anything after that. Hoofda. Sorry, just give me a second here. Noah, can you please go out to the media room with your sister? Noah, please go out there with your sister, bud. You take him out there for me. You got to be quiet in here, okay, bud? You got to be quiet when we're in here.
I have hiccups.
You got the hiccups? Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure those are covered too. Thank you, Lord. Well, Father, we take this bread tonight. Oh, the bread of your body, Lord, that was broken for us. That it says you were rejected for us so that we don't have to be rejected. You were despised. You took upon sorrow. You took upon grief. You took upon sickness. You took upon disease. You took upon sin. You took upon iniquity. You took everything upon your body for us, so that we could be free, so that we could be delivered, so that we could be healed. Now, Father, we take this bread, the bread of life. We take in the very life of God into our bodies right now in Jesus' name. Lord, we take this blood, the blood of Jesus that was shed for our healing for our divine health. For our healing in every part of our body and every part of our heart and every part of our mind. We thank you, Lord, for the blood that you shed on our behalf, for us, for our freedom and our healing, in Jesus' name. The life is in the blood. Oh. The life is in the blood. Life is in the blood. Father, we thank you for your word tonight. We thank you for your word, Lord. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the glory of your word. Ooh. We thank you for what you have done for us. We thank you for the ability to give into the kingdom of God, to sow into the kingdom of God, to sow financially, to sow our time, to sow our energy, sow our gifts, our hearts, our abilities, everything you've given us. Ooh. So we bless every seed that is sown tonight, Lord. I ask you to heal every person that is listening. I ask you to bless every person. Bless their seed that is sown. Multiply it back to them. Multiply it back to them, Lord. Multiply it back to them. Meet their needs, meet their dreams, meet their desires. Fulfill every single desire, every want that they have. Bless them beyond their wildest dreams. Bless them beyond what they ever even thought was possible. Show them what an amazing God you are. Good Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.